born into poverty in Minsk, Russia in 1884. Spent his childhood in St. John, New Brunswick, Canada, working in the scrap metal business to help support his family. At age 20, while watching vaudeville at the theater, Mayer was captivated by the entertainment business. He would go on to own the largest chain of theaters in Haverhill, Massachusetts, and then to create his own production company, Louis B. Mayer Pictures Corporation. This was just the beginning of a path that would lead him to become chief of the biggest and most successful film studio of Hollywood's golden age, MGM. Mayer made great films and great stars. Joan Crawford, one of Mayer's leading ladies, who starred in dozens of MGM films beginning in 1925.
Well, how about some tea, then?
Tea would spoil my dinner. Only have one meal a day, and I'd rather hate to spoil it.
Nobody'd give Buck a job on the radio, the old meanie, so I had to buy out Dandy Gelatine.
Come a tie-eye, yippee-yippee-yay, Crystal.
You can buy it now, dear, and give Buck away with every package.
Well, girls, looks like it's back to the perfume counter for me. And by the way, there's a name for you ladies, but it isn't used in high society, outside of a kennel.
Did she?
Yes, and now just hold still. There we are. Is that better? This is a most generous gesture.
I never make generous gestures, as these two will tell you.
Thank you very much, Miss Holmes.
It's a name which might be of some assistance to you.
Oh, really?
In certain quarters where the name of Baring has perhaps lost its metric. Good night, Mr. Baring.
Good night, Miss Holmes.
Lana Turner, who was discovered while drinking a soda at a Hollywood cafe, and went on to make 36 films for MGM.
When Cyrano was telling Roxanne the meaning of a kiss,
yeah, what's that?
The kiss, he said. I do not see why your lips do not dare one. It is the divine secret which one mouth tells the other while neither needs to listen. It is the pilgrimage of the heart across the lips to the soul.
Cyrano, huh? Well, I'll go for that. What do I read about the guy? I guess the girl said yes, huh?
No. No, he was making love for Christian, his best friend. He sent Christian to receive the kiss.
Why? What was his angle?
Well, you see, he was afraid. He was very ugly.
Oh.
What's wrong? You're not going to read it?
No. Ugly or not, I'm not interested in a guy that doesn't go through with what he starts.
What are we going to do?
That's great coming from you. You've been high-hatting me the way you have.
What else could I do? Oh, Frank. Frank, if I'd only met you first.
Well?
Frank, do you love me?
Yes.
Do you love me so much that nothing else matters?
Yes.
There's one thing we could do that would fix everything for us.
What? Pray for something to happen in it?
Something like that.
Cora.
Well, you suggested it yourself once, didn't you?
I was only joking.
Were you?
Yes, I was.
Well, had you started to think about it a little?
Maybe I said it, but I didn't really mean it.
Well, I say it again now, and I do mean it.
Greta Garbo, whom Mayer discovered and brought to America from Sweden in 1925.
I don't think either of you for a living. I'll make it myself one way or another. I am my own boss. So put that in your pipe and smoke it.
You're a strange boy who loves you.
Do you?
I love you as one adores sacred things.
What sacred things?
God, country, honor, you.
I come last?
No.
That's how you said it.
You come first, before anything.
Before anything?
Yes.
Crawford, Turner, Garbo, Louis B. Mayer. Here's the inside story from New York Times best-selling author Scott Eyman.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage New York Times best-selling author Scott Eyman and Emmy Award winner Steven Caras.
Sound? Good.
Testing, testing. Oh, we're live.
Good. Scott Eyman, if you did not read your bios yet, is one of our country's most highly respected film historians. He is a New York Times best-selling author, times three. He's done 15 books. He's working on his 16th. And how did you find the time to come out today? Thank you, Scott, so much for being here.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thank you so much. Before we get into our subject, I would like to mention that there are several Kravis board members here today. Judith Mitchell, of course, the CEO of the Kravis Center, but John Kessler, the Kravis Center board vice chair. John, here you are. And he is also the chairman of the Kravis 2020 capital campaign, involving all of the renovation that you're seeing going on right now, making this place even better for all of us. If you'd like to know more about that, be a part of it, contact John or the development team. They're wonderful people. And I think, I'm not sure if he's here or not, Robert Frommer, but he was supposed to be here, another fellow board member of Scott. So thank you very much, the board of Kravis, because you're helping the Kravis, but as a result, you're helping the community. I would also like to mention something that a lot of you are aware of already, but I must do this because there are, I'm sure, with a crowd like this, some newcomers as well. Since 1992, 2.5 million plus children, young students from Palm Beach, Broward, Martin, St. Lucie, and Okeechobee counties have visited the Kravis Center, attending performances through the Star Series programming. They're wonderful educational initiatives, and these kids' lives are better as a result of this. And I'm not sure you're aware of this or not, but thanks to you coming here, you make it possible for these kids. And in their young years, when their hard drives aren't standing room only, they're especially receptive to performers and the confidence that they come with and the joy in doing what it is they do. And that's contagious. They take that back to their lives, and their lives are better as a result. So 2.5 plus million kids, thank all of you. And thank you from the Kravis Center as well. So Scott, when we met 10 years ago, you were both the book editor and the art critic for the Palm Beach Post. And at the time, you were doing freelance work for the Wall Street Journal and the then New York Observer. Did you make any enemies in your reviews, because I don't think you can say, well, I'd rather not write about that because I didn't love it. And one hate letter that comes to mind, perhaps, or no?
It wasn't a hate letter. It was a package. I reviewed a book by an author who shall remain nameless because you wouldn't recognize his name anyway. And I didn't like it much. It was a thriller. And 5 or 6 days later, I got a box at the office. And I opened it, and it was very neatly wrapped excrement.
Oh, okay.
That was my favorite reader response in the 20-odd years I was a book critic.
Is that on your mantle today?
No.
Scott is also a professor at the University of Miami. I forgot to add that, which is pretty awesome. When did you discover you wanted to be a messenger on paper?
Oh, maybe junior high. I felt an affinity for sentences. Mm-hmm. I just didn't know how to go about making a living at it. I'm still working at that aspect of it.
Doesn't look that way. are you passionate about research? Because you're not making anything up. Everything you write about is true.
Page 438 is full of things I made up, actually. Oh. No. It's my favorite part of a book, research and the first draft, because that's where the creativity happens. In the research, you find your narrative and you find your characters, and the first draft is the creative part. After that, it's essentially drudgery. But that's what makes it as good as it can be, is the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth drafts. But the fun part is the initial infatuation. Oh.
Who tells you that you are a New York Times best-selling author of one of those three books? You get a text, you get a trophy, you get a phone call.
In my case, it was a phone. They call you on the phone, and they're very excited. Because in the publishing world, if you get a book, on they have certain sales parameters. And if an editor gets X number of books on the New York Times list in a given year, he gets a bonus. So they're very excited when they call you, you know. And probably even more excited than I am. But it's a moment in a writer's career. Because it's not something you ever imagined would actually happen.
That's cool. How long did it take to write Lion of Hollywood, The Life and Legend of Louis B. Mayer, published by Simon & Schuster, 2005?
5 years. It would have taken 4, but I made a terrible mistake. I overwrote. The manuscript was twice as long as the book. So I had to take, actually it was over a year, to cut it down to a length that it interested me. But I got lost in the narrative, and I just sort of kept going and going and going. And it was the only time that's ever happened where I stopped my editorial function as I was working. Wow. I just sort of put it all down. Mm-hmm. And it would have been a two-volume book, and I honestly didn't think the world was waiting for two volumes on Louis B. Mayer.
It must have felt great when you learned that Louis B. Mayer's grandson, no, David Selznick, I'm sorry, his grandson authorized...
No, Dan Selznick is L.B. Mayer's grandson.
Oh, okay.
He's Irene Mayer Selznick's son.
Okay. Yeah. So how did that come about?
I sent him one of my books. I think I sent him my John Ford biography and a cover letter. And Dan is he's still around. Dan is very, reads everything and sees everything and thinks about everything. So he hadn't read the book, but he had heard about me. So I was standing on second base and I didn't even know it, you know. Mm-hmm. So all I had to do was really round third and go home.
Nice.
And he was worried because he absolutely hated everything that had been written about his grandfather before, because he didn't recognize the man he knew in the various movies and in the one previous biography that had been written about L.B. Mayer.
And he would know.
He knew.
The way Robert Wagner approached you, mm-hmm. you'd done two books with him, mm-hmm. one or both are bestsellers?
Both.
Both. He was so relieved that you wrote about a certain person that he knows that you...
Two people he knew. He had read the book.
Okay, so finally he said,
right.
Somebody is saying in print what this person, the essence right. of this person.
He knew both Irene and Edie, who were Mayer's two daughters.
Okay.
And he said, usually when you read a book about people you know, that involves people you know, you don't recognize them. He said, but when I read you what you wrote about Irene and Edie, you nailed them. They were exactly the way you described them. And the relationship was exactly the way you described them. So he said, that's what intrigued me about making contact with you. But it was that's fortuitous. A book is a rock thrown in the pond, and the ripples spread out, and you don't know where the ripples are going to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're passionate about this subject, obviously.
And chocolate chip cookies.
All right. Yeah. I thought I was in the wrong zip code, by the way, when the chicken came. I mean, it didn't come. I mean, it was salmon, wasn't it?
It was good. It was very good.
It was very so. Very congratulations to the Caras coming into some new money. Thank you very much. And more needed for the capital campaign, Zingo. Okay, so on the subject of your passion and film, a lot of names changed between Ellis Island and stepping onto the shores of this country. And Louis B. Mayer's name, his family's name, no exception. What was the name, and how long did it take to become Louis B. Mayer?
Well, the name was either Bayer or Meyer, M-I-E-R. We're not sure. He was born in a little town in the Urals. And I sent a researcher to Belarus to investigate what could be found of his birthplace records. And all the birth records for the late 19th and early 20th centuries were destroyed between World War I and World War II because of the German and Russian armies bouncing back and forth and blowing everything up in their path. So you have to go back to immigration records. Mm-hmm. And he gave two different birth dates and two different places on his immigration records. One for when he came to Canada and one for when he came to the United States. I suspect that the 1883 birth date is the correct one. He also gave 1885, and that a date in May of 1883. Because when he became a citizen in the United States, he adopted July 4th, 1885 as his birth date. And I think he was just emulating George M. Cohan and trying to be ultra patriotic by taking July 4th.
My father did the same thing, coming from Greece, July 4th. Nobody knows his birthday. That's interesting.
But he went for July 4th. See, I mean, maybe a lot of immigrants chose July 4th to be more American than Americans.
Wow. Perhaps. So tell us a little bit about the sibling relationships with LB and his brother.
He had five, there were five children in the family.
There was a brother that he looked after.
There was a brother. Well, he was because his father was unsuccessful in the business of life, he could never really make much of a living for the family. He was a quasi-rabbinical scholar without portfolio. And they moved from Russia to St. John, New Brunswick, when Louis was about five. And there were 9 or 10 Jewish families in St. John, New Brunswick at that point. So there wasn't a lot of call for rabbinical scholars. So basically, Louis left school at the age of 12. So he could read, write, and do his arithmetic, but not much more than that. And he became a junk dealer. He would have a bag over his shoulder, and he'd go picking up scrap metal in the foundries of St. John. And because St. John's a big boating center, there was a lot of scrap metal. But he was supporting the family when he was 12 years old. It's a classic immigrant saga,
right,
really.
Right. It's not unusual. It's
no.
True. The dynamic, the father abusive, the mother Virgin Mary kind of?
Yes, thing? Yes. It was the father was frustrated and angry, and he could never put enough food on the table, and the mother somehow made do. Mm-hmm. She provided with Louis's help, because Louis was out there on the streets working.
Right.
The father was angry. He would beat the kids. The mother would try to negotiate some sort of peace. So Mayer, Louis, basically worshipped his mother and tended to worship women like his mother, mm-hmm. That he saw as emulating her characteristics.
Right. Yeah.
But he tended to be domineering with men because he would never allow any other man to do to him what his father had done to him.
Right, right. He left school, as you said, around 12. Mm-hmm. He felt the need to support the family.
It was a necessity. They would have starved if he hadn't quit school.
Wasn't worth much. He was intrigued with vaudeville early on, though, around that age when he witnessed a performance.
Mm-hmm.
which led to movies. And
He came to Haverhill, Mass. He immigrated when he left St. John's as a teenager. He went to Haverhill, Massachusetts, and he took his accumulated money and opened a derelict theater. He had either $300 or $500. The amount varied in the telling. But he took what he had and invested it in this derelict theater, fixed it up himself. His brothers came in and did the carpentry and the electrical work and all that. And they opened this theater, and it was a success. And one theater led to two theaters and led to three theaters.
Was that the Gem Theater?
Yes, that was the first one.
So this is... Didn't he marry at about 19?
Yes, he married a rabbi's daughter named Margaret Schenberg, who was from Boston. Mm-hmm. And she was, again, he saw her as his mother redux. She had that same kind of nurturing instinct that he desperately needed in his life.
The theater was, they had two daughters, Edith.
Mm-hmm. Edie and Irene.
And Irene. Mm-hmm. And the Gem Theater, before his renovation, there's a funny story about that.
It was a really down and dirty dump. And the story went that just before it closed, the reason it closed was the MC came out and introduced, and now for your entertainment will be Blanche Fernandez singing White Wings. And from the back of the theater, someone yelled out, "Blanche Fernandez, she's a whore." And the MC went, "Nevertheless, Blanche Fernandez will now sing White Wings." So it was that kind of a place. It was a raucous dump.
I think I would have enjoyed that, from the back of the house.
Yeah.
So it was aided by family funds that he renovated this
And the theater. Assistance of his brothers.
His in-law family funds, certainly not his father.
They helped.
Oh, okay.
But he was very smart. He expanded the business. And if you look at the progression of his professional instincts, it's very logical. He takes steps one at a time. When he opened a vaudeville house and it began to be successful, he then took some of the profits and bought an interest in a hotel where the vaudeville acts would be directed to stay. So he may have been paying them, but he was getting some of the money back in rentals for the hotel where they were staying. So, I mean, he had the instincts of an entrepreneur.
Yeah. And the two theaters became four theaters, became more theaters, became building his own 1,500 seat.
Right. The Colonial.
The Colonial.
And then we move into the movie business.
Getting others on board is an enormous talent. We know that. Any of us who have tried to raise money, whether we're board members, whether we're development people, whether we're just part of a team and we love something, he had the gift to not only get people on board, but to become so enthusiastic about it that they had to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. This was innate in him, no?
He could have been a football coach. He had that ability to inspire others, and because he worked 18 hours a day, and because of the pace he set. When I did the book, I talked to a guy who was his office boy in the 1930s, and the kid was 15 years old at the time. And he said, "I could barely keep up with him when he walked through the studio, because he didn't walk, it was a trot. He literally did not walk, he moved at a very rapid pace." And he was like that until shortly before he died. Yeah. You know, his energy was astonishing.
Yeah.
And he could also inspire others because he believed in what he was doing passionately, and he could infuse that into other people.
The lion incorporated in the films, that came early on, that came around this time, around the Colonial Theater. How did that come?
He had a photograph that's in the book, and he had an artist paint a portrait of him based on this photograph that he liked. And it was mounted in the lobby of the Colonial Theater as, you know, our founder, you know, your host, Louis B. Mayer. And below that was the insignia of a lion, which he'd chosen, which he didn't know was going to be, I don't think at that point, the logo of MGM, you know.
Mm-hmm. What about his stock company management? He started to manage some stock companies, but only insisted, of course, on presenting the best plays.
Right.
How long a period did he work with that before it was movie time?
3 or 4 or 5 years. What he learned from this which led into the movie business. What he learned from this is that stars are actually more important than the vehicle they're appearing in. That if people have a bond with an actor or an actress, they will go to see that person. And even if the play or the movie is they'll still feel they got their money's worth if the star is presented the way they like to see that star presented. And that's what he strove to do, beginning with the theatrical presentations. And then he moved into films and in Boston, basically. It started in Haverhill, but by the time he was through, he was the largest motion picture exhibitor in New England.
This was in 20-something.
Yeah. He bought the foundation of his fortune was he bought the New England rights to D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation, which was the blockbuster of the pre-World War I era. The price was $50,000. And in 1915, $50,000 is $1.3 million in modern money. That's a lot of money. All of his cash was invested in his theaters. He didn't have $50,000 in cash. So what he did was he took out a second mortgage on his house. He sold his wife's jewelry. He sold everything he could have that he could raise, and he got the $50,000. And he bought the New England rights to the Birth of a Nation. And he made a profit of $300,000 to $350,000 on his investment. And from that became Louis B. Mayer Productions. And in that era, you could make a movie, a very well-budgeted movie, for $60,000 to $75,000. So that was the beginning. Beginning of his career in the movies. Yeah. But he took the gamble on The Birth of a Nation because he smelled success. He smelled the next logical stage.
Well, he said something about God and his mother.
He said, only God means more to me than my mother. And the fact that she died when they were still living in St. John, New Brunswick. Margaret Schenberg, his wife, really was an emotional replacement for his mother. Because by the time he went to Haverhill, his mother was gone. She was buried in St. John. She's still buried in St. John.
Yeah.
He never moved her. Even he thought about having her moved out to California after he became successful in Los Angeles so the whole family could be together. But he decided not to do it.
So God and his mother. So his wife, Margaret, gets the bronze.
She got third billing. She got third billing, yeah.
Okay, Hollywood 1918, off he goes with family. Tell us about Hollywood then and his take to it.
Well, for everybody who came to Hollywood in that era, this was paradise, and especially for a guy who'd been born in Russia with the pogroms going on all around him. All he remembered about Russia was that he was A, cold, and B, hungry. That was his memory until he was 5 years old. In St. John, of course, his memory was of grinding, back-breaking labor and having to fight all the time because the other kids wanted to take the Jews' scrap metal from him so they could sell the scrap metal, you know? Mm-hmm. So it had just been a nonstop uphill battle psychologically for Mayer. But when he got to Los Angeles, there's no pollution. There are orange groves everywhere, so at night you could smell the orange blossoms. All you had to do was leave your windows open. The climate was idyllic, and it was warm. And it rained, 6 weeks a year. Other than that, it was just beautiful spring weather all the time. So he found it as paradise.
First, he rented some studios.
Yes.
But it wasn't long before he owned some.
Right.
Tell us about that progression.
He rented space that was called the Mission Road Studio. It's now a public park in Los Angeles. But again, he's moving very logically because he's moving into production, which is a bigger piece of the profits if it's a success, but it's also a bigger risk because you're investing more capital. So he's making films. He bought a star whose contract was about to be up, whose films he thought she was good and she had a public, so he signed a contract with her. But he didn't invest in a studio at that point. He rented the facilities to try to keep his $350,000 and nurture it as much as possible. And of course, in the movie business, if you make a movie, you don't see it back. You don't see the money back for a year. 9 months, a year, the check doesn't come back from the bank. So he had to have enough money to make not one picture, he had to have enough money to make three or four before he actually saw any money coming back. But he's working, so he decided to rent facilities rather than build a facility. But by 1921, he built his own lot. He bought a lot, it was a pre-existing lot that he bought, actually.
Mm-hmm. He had early stage fright, and I put that in quotes, when asking investors for money. Mm-hmm. He could turn on the tears like the greatest of actors.
Right.
He also faked fainting mm-hmm. when the bill collectors came. Mm-hmm. So he was the biggest star of MGM, but he was never in a film.
Every actor I talked to who worked for him said he was the best actor they ever saw. That he could actually, if a bill collector came and he really didn't have the money because the check hadn't arrived, he could literally turn white and pass out. And they understood the fake pass out, but they didn't understand how he did the color. And he was absolutely believable. I mean, you thought he was going to die. You thought he was having a massive coronary right there. And it was completely a dramatic effect, you know? But it was necessity. It was necessity.
So that's how he spotted good actors, I suppose. His style in film, throughout his life, what he was just so insistent about. How would you briefly describe his...
He liked family films. He was very interesting in that he believed in the things... He believed in his own sets of values. And he thought that the rest of America also shared those values. So he didn't cynically make pictures he didn't believe in. He made pictures that he wanted to see, in the theory that if he wanted to see it, then the audience would want to see it as well. And that's, in fact, the way it worked out, to actually, I think, probably a greater extent than he'd ever actually imagined, mm-hmm. you know? For instance, he disliked violence. He really disliked violence. So either Louis B. Mayer Productions or MGM, when the merger occurred in 1924, MGM made very few gangster pictures, made very few Westerns, because they're intrinsically violent genres. But he didn't want to see that on the screen, so that's not what they did. I interviewed Adolph Green and Betty Comden and Green for the book, and Adolph Green told me if you wanted to sell a script to L.B. Mayer, all you had to do was write a scene where people in tuxedos are standing on a balcony drinking champagne over Fifth Avenue. And he'd think it was a wonderful script, whether it made any sense or not. But what he wanted was to project an aura of class, of gentility, of elegance, because that's what he aspired to. And that's what America had given him, so he wanted to, in turn around and present that to the rest of America, especially if the audience was made up of people who could not stand on a balcony in evening clothes with a glass of champagne overlooking Fifth Avenue.
So he's working the middle class.
Yes. Totally aspirational, the aspirational yeah. middle class, right. Absolutely.
To say he was an overprotective father of his two daughters would be an understatement. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, Edie, or Edith, his daughter who showed great promise as an actress, mm-hmm. what did he say to her?
Edie wanted to be an actress, and she had some skills. And he watched her act, and he said, you know, you're very good, you can be a very good actress, but you need to develop those skills for life, not for show business. And he wouldn't let her become an actress. Similarly, Irene wanted to be a doctor, and he wouldn't let her go to college. He wouldn't let either of the girls go to college. The dynamic between the girls was interesting. Edie was her mother's child, emotionally. Margaret loved her home. She ran a beautiful home. She could cook. She was a very domestic creature. Edie became the doyenne of Beverly Hills society with her husband, Bill Guest. She had the best collection of Impressionist paintings. Irene was her father's daughter. Irene was very smart. She was very calculating. She was very tough. You didn't cross Irene, which is the primary reason that Irene and Edie never got along, because they were completely different human beings. Mm-hmm. They really were.
Yeah.
Irene didn't respect Edie, because all Edie was the wife, and she ran a Beverly Hills home. And what's so tough about that? Irene went to New York and produced Streetcar Named Desire mm-hmm. and Bell Book and Candle. She had an independent career of her own. Her father wouldn't let her go to college, but Irene did a workaround. And of course, her father respected her all the more because she did a workaround, as he would have done, as he did do, when his father he would beat him and, you know, not be able to support the family. Mm. LB went and did a workaround.
So he empowered women at work, mm-hmm. but just the opposite at home.
Basically.
Right.
Basically.
Enter Irving Thalberg. Mm-hmm. Can you briefly describe him personally and his physical appearance? He's a little man and about 14 years younger. Mm-hmm. And what was his role?
Irving Thalberg had been running production at Universal Pictures. Carl Laemmle, who ran Universal, wanted Thalberg to marry Laemmle's daughter. And Thalberg thought about it, and they dated for a while, but he wasn't feeling it. And then when he told his boss that he couldn't marry Rosabel, her name was Rosabel, suddenly the temperature dropped precipitously at Universal. And Thalberg realized he was going to have to leave Universal because he just shafted himself out of a job by not marrying the boss's daughter. So he went to work for LB. Thalberg basically ran production, and LB Mayer ran the overall. Mm-hmm. He told Irving what he wanted to see in his pictures and what he didn't want to see. Irving was in charge of finding the stories, and between the two of them, they would cast the pictures and edit the pictures.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The ongoing relationship between them in the beginning was very good.
They were very good.
It was very good until it wasn't.
Right.
What did LB say about... It was a pretty strong quote about directors, because he had a real hard time with directors. Mm-hmm. Tell us why and tell us what he said.
Well, both Thalberg and Mayer saw movies the same way. They saw movies as a medium where the producer needed to maintain control. Thalberg said that by far the most important component of movie making is the writer, but we can never let them find it out. And they didn't. A director working for Thalberg or Mayer at MGM was in a subsidiary position because they tended to move directors in and out. You know, if a director had a headache or got arrested for drunk driving or something, they just put another director on the picture. It didn't matter who was directing the picture because they essentially had control over the presentation of the stars and how the film would be edited. So directors were mostly interchangeable. They had a couple good directors. George Cukor, who directed The Women and The Philadelphia Story, was a very good director. King Vidor was a very good director. Clarence Brown was a very good director. Right. After that, things got real bad real fast. Mm. And there was an interchangeability. Same thing with writers. They would often assign a script to two or three writers at the same time without the writers knowing about it. And when the scripts came in, they'd cherry-pick a scene from this guy's script and a scene from that guy's script and put the script they wanted to see together. So...
And the artist was very offended.
Yes.
The writer. Understandably.
Sure, absolutely.
It's a giant business, and they were just one of the wheels that made it roll.
It was a factory operation, and they were the foreman, basically.
LB said in your book, give me a great producer and a great star, and you can F your directors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
One of his more gentle quotes.
Well, the other good one, of course, is when he told Irving, you can be the nice guy, Irving, I'll be the prick.
Yeah.
And that's basically the way it ran.
That was his advice on Irving's way in.
Yeah. He was willing to be the heavy, because Irving actually had his own issues. Irving was kind of cold. He was not a cold fish exactly, but he was kind of aesthetic, and he also had a clock ticking in his head, because Irving Thalberg had a rheumatic heart. He'd had rheumatic fever as a child, and it was clear he was not going to live a long life. So Irving heard every tick of the clock was one tick closer to Forest Lawn, as far as Irving was concerned. So he was interested in accumulating money and accumulating credentials and accumulating renown as fast as possible, because he knew he was not going to be a long-distance runner.
Wow. No one talks about the lighting and makeup people, and mm-hmm. I'm being a photographer, mm-hmm. loving those days and that black and white when you couldn't go in post and fix it, and there was no HD, thank God, but they had to work in tandem together. Mm-hmm. The makeup artist needed to know what the lighting was in order how to apply. Was there any respect for the makeup and lighting people?
Oh, God.
You don't read about that much.
Well, see, they got down into the granular level of presentation. For instance, at MGM, they spent more money than any other studio spent. Per picture, their budgets were much higher because Mayer wanted the pictures to be as good as they possibly could. One of the last pictures Mayer produced was American in Paris with Gene Kelly. And they shot the entire picture, and then they were going to shut down to do the ballet at the very tail end of the picture. And a lot of people at the studio said, why are we doing this? Because we've got all these musical numbers already shot in the picture, and the ballet's going to cost $500,000. Why don't we just not do the ballet and save $500,000? And Mayer said, spend the $500,000. If a producer genuinely thought they could make a movie better by spending $50,000 or $100,000 or $500,000, he'd okay it without question. He didn't even blink about it. He felt the same way about presentation. Since they spent a lot of money, he wanted the sets to be seen. You didn't see dark lighting like you saw at Warner Brothers in an MGM picture. You saw those sets. You saw Cedric Gibbons's Art Deco sets in high key. Similarly, the stars were presented in a very idealized fashion. When Robert Taylor, takes a bullet, he still looks good. and Gable always had that little forelock over his forehead, looking as sexy and roguish as possible, despite whether he was slapping the leading lady around or not. He was still going to look like Clark Gable. And they were absolutely insistent on the way the stuff was lit. And the studio heads, not Mayer or Thalberg, but for instance, the head of the camera department, Cedric Gibbons, who was head of the art department, all these guys had a lot of power. Cedric Gibbons could short-circuit any director's plans for lighting a set if Cedric Gibbons didn't approve of the way the guy was going to light his sets. That Cedric Gibbons, the art director, had more power than most directors at MGM.
Mm-hmm. Good. I'm glad to hear all that.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was a good gamble because American in Paris made $3 million and it got the Academy Award.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
He had this awesome foresight, and he didn't freak out if something lost a little money. In today's world, you make one mistake and you're out.
No.
In those days, some films lost, and he still believed in the team that he put together.
Well, it was a different business because essentially it was a singles and doubles business. If you put Gable and Lana Turner in a picture, you knew you'd gross X number of dollars, barring nuclear holocaust, but unless something went radically, radically wrong, you were guaranteed a certain gross, and as long as you could control your costs, you could guarantee yourself a profit. Because of Mayer's basic theory was that stars are the most important component of a picture, and that's where the investment went, and that's why the presentation of his stars was so crucial to him.
Right.
But he didn't always know who was going to hit. Joan Crawford, they never saw coming. Gable, they didn't see coming. Joan Crawford was one of the girls signed for $75 a week in 1925. Every studio in that era would sign 10 or 20 of them. Mm-hmm. Most of them washed out in a year or two. And if you look at Crawford's early pictures now, there's something going on. She's a spark. She's alive. There's an electricity to her. Even as a kid, she's 19 or 20 years old. But they didn't see it because they didn't treat her any better initially than they treated any other 10 or 20 girls they hired that year for $75 a week. Mm-hmm. But that was the theory. If you bring enough young talent in, they're all not going to hit. But if you bring in 20 of them, two or three might hit, And the only way to find that out is to put them in a movie and see if the camera loves them.
Right. Ben-Hur was an expensive mess in the beginning. He went over to Italy.
The first Ben-Hur, yeah.
Right? He went over to Italy to try and fix things. Mm-hmm. Well, he got sick, he lost his teeth, mm-hmm. but he gained a star because he discovered Garbo.
Garbo.
Tell us about that relationship with Garbo and Mayer. He hired her right away for a mm-hmm. five-year contract, $400 a week, mm-hmm. I think. Mm-hmm. And 40 years later, my beginning salary at New York City Ballet was $95 a week, and that's the best company in the country, biggest. So that $400 a week,
that's good money.
That was really great money for an unknown. And didn't they have to do a number of makeovers on her as well? Or
He was in, they had this runaway production. It was Ben-Hur. It was just completely out of control. They were shooting it in Italy. It ended up costing $4 million. And $4 million in 1925 is an astonishing amount of money. So he went over, basically he made the decision, we're closing the picture down, we're going to shoot it back in Los Angeles, which is what happened. On the way back, now he as I said, he was poor, he didn't have any dental care as a kid growing up, and he got his teeth got infected when he's over in Europe, so he had to have all of his teeth pulled. And he had to wear false teeth for the rest of his life, which is why you never see pictures of him smiling. Because for one thing, he had bad teeth as a young man, and then he had false teeth, and he was very conscious of it. So he tended to keep his mouth shut when a photographer was around. But he stops over in Berlin to look at some movies, because that's the business he's in. And they take him to see this movie called The Saga of Gösta Berling, which was a famous Swedish novel by a novelist named Selma Lagerlöf. And he didn't know from Gösta Berling, and he didn't really care. But he saw this face. Now, Garbo is, I think, 19 or 20 at this point. And he said, there's something behind her eyes. That's the way he put it. He said, there's something behind her eyes. He said, we have to hire her, and we have to hire the director. But if we can only hire one, hire her. He hired them both. The director washed out. He didn't adjust. But she stayed. She stayed. And he said, to the end of his days, there were only three great actors that he had at MGM, really. There are movie stars, and there are people who are more than movie stars. Garbo, Spencer Tracy, and Marie Dressler. He said, those were great actors. He always thought that those were the three, because they were more than movie stars. They were doing something that you can't teach in drama school.
Sure.
Yeah.
So did people, I don't think we decipher between the two. You know, Grace Kelly is a movie star.
Right.
And she was a wonderful actress.
Yeah.
But then there are other people that are taken more seriously as actors. How was Greta Garbo in the day-to-day at MGM? Was she she didn't seem like a people person?
No.
Like an aw shucks kind of pat you on the back,
no.
Help you carry your stuff up the stairs kind of
no,
person?
No, no, no,
no.
She never picked up a check, no. She showed up, but the thing about Garbo was she's a one-off. Her rhythm is so different. It was different than, she's slow. She's mournful. She's kind of like somnambulistic. She's moving at a different pace than everybody else around her. And it shouldn't work, but it does somehow, because what sets her apart is her weird rhythm, is that thing of her fatalism, which comes through her slowness.
Always.
And her,
even when she was joyful, I wanted to cry.
Yeah, I know. But she was a one-off. She was totally different than anybody else of the time. She's totally different than anybody now. And I think it's when you talk to young people today, by young I mean 35, the actresses that they know are Bette Davis, Barbara Stanwyck, Joan Crawford, all of whom are electric. You can feel the pulse.
Right.
You can feel the vitality in them. They don't talk about Garbo. And I think that's because that weird rhythm she had worked for audiences of her time and for the generation after she quit the business. But for a modern audience used to the incessant pace of phones and constant feed, they just fall asleep watching Garbo.
She would have pooped out a lot earlier had she been in this generation. I don't think she would have been able to cope with all the electronics, or she would have been one of those people.
She wouldn't have paid any attention to any of it. She wouldn't have paid.
Well, John Gilbert proposed to her, and her response was, "I want to be alone," or
more or less. More or less. He fell madly in love with her. She fell madly in like with him. She was new in town, and she was scared, and she never felt comfortable in Hollywood. She much preferred New York because she could be anonymous in New York. You can get lost in New York, and she loved being lost in the big city. In L.A., in that era, you couldn't get lost because it was such a small town, a company town, and she stood out. And she hated standing out, but she loved New York. That's why she spent the rest of her life there
in
after
hiding,
she quit the business.
Basically.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. In
hiding.
In hiding.
All kinds of stories about.
But and she stood Gilbert up on their wedding day. She just didn't show up.
Yeah.
She just didn't show up. And she always reserved the right to go home, psychologically.
Right.
Psychologically. Right. So even she was different than anybody else at the studio.
Mm-hmm. LB was very conservative about people's behavior.
He was conservative politically, too.
Well, very much so, yeah. How he managed to keep them well-behaved within what I consider to be more of a civilization than an industry was an ongoing thing. So there were good things about him doing this with, you know, enforcing certain rules. Like, he was okay, even though he couldn't understand the homosexuality and stuff, as long as people were quiet and dignified and kept that to themselves. Right. But it didn't keep him from getting people to get married or at least date for the always about the image.
Right.
But what I read in the book that I admired enormously was when Lena Horne was involved in making Cabin in the Sky, and the commissary discriminated against blacks in there until he heard about it and took his Khrushchev shoe on the table and banged it for the right reasons. Mm-hmm. But then again, he didn't want her to marry the white man.
No, well, that was a bridge too far for Mayer. Right. I mean, because they made this all-black film called Cap in the Sky. It's lovely. And they had an all-black cast, Lena Horne, Eddie Rochester Anderson, Ethel Waters, and the commissary didn't want to serve him. Well, that lasted for about 15 minutes when he heard about that. He set him straight real fast. But Lena Horne married Lenny Hayton, who worked in the music department at MGM. Very good arranger, composer, conductor. And they kept it very quiet. They kept it very quiet because they always had a problem with Lena Horne with theaters south of the Mason-Dixon line, because they would simply cut Lena Horne out of their film, out of MGM films. So the theaters would run town till her first close-up, splice, take her scene out, and then she'd disappear. They wouldn't show a sexually alluring black woman in Southern theaters. It was but MGM kept her on the lot for 6 or 7 years because she was very talented. Mayer liked her, and I think he kind of liked the idea of having a black movie star too. Mm-hmm. You know, even though they could only book her in the North.
And it wasn't the fact that he was in his political corner for and his stance as a person with his opinions. It was truly who he was and what he believed in. It was, but there were certain decisions made for the success of the industry that we'll get to. But let's talk about his theory on sound briefly, when sound came along. He said, basically, let's let other people, he didn't jump on the bandwagon.
No.
Everybody jumped, and it was pretty bad in the beginning. But he said, let's let everybody else figure it out soon.
And to let them go ahead, and we'll come in when things are nailed down. We'll come in and do it. Because he wasn't in the business of competing with Warner Brothers or Paramount in his mind. Because the MGM was formed in 1924. By 1927, they were the most successful studio in Hollywood, making far more money than any other studio. He didn't regard anybody as competition to MGM. He wasn't concerned about keeping up with the Joneses. He figured they should keep up with him. Mm-hmm. So sound lands in late 27, early 28, and he said, fine. Garbo doesn't make its sound film till 1930, more than two years after sound hits. Because they needed to find the right material for her. They weren't sure about her voice, which is kind of low and smoky and slow. But they weren't going to give her speech lessons either because they're afraid she'd walk. You know, so but they protected her by putting her in a context. They bought Eugene O'Neill's Anna Christie, where she's playing a Swedish girl in New York City. Okay, so she's not being asked to do anything she's not familiar with. So they were protecting a very valuable property. But that was typical of the way he thought. Let other people, you know, they can rush on in. I don't care. We're going to do it the MGM way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. LB's daughters get married. Mm-hmm. Edith to Bill Getz and Irene to David Selznick. So was LB basically okay with this? How did he feel about these two guys?
He respected David Selznick, but he was worried about David Selznick. correctly so, as it turned out. Mm-hmm. He, because David Selznick's father, he was named Louis Selznick, and he was a degenerate gambler. And he was a successful producer in the early 1920s who basically gambled all his money away and ended up broke. And he was concerned that Irene's new husband, David Selznick, would have some of the same traits, which in fact he did. But until those traits came out and erupted in middle age, David Selznick was one of the two or three best producers of his day. He did Gone with the Wind, he did the Ronald Coleman Tale of Two Cities, he did The First Star Is Born. He's a brilliant, brilliant producer. But as he got more and more successful, he got more and more crazy. And eventually, Irene had to cut bait, and she divorced because she said, look, you either stop gambling, you have to stop gambling, and you have to give up Jennifer Jones. And he gave up neither. So she divorced him, went to New York, and produced Streetcar Named Desire, and proved her point. Mm.
Problems started brewing between Thalberg and LB around 1932. Uh-huh. LB was 47, Thalberg was 33. You said in your book that there were no friends among the upper echelon at MGM, only shifting alliances based on self-interest. There's nothing new about that.
No, that's right? Typical.
I mean, that's
normal.
World.
That's normal.
Were there casting couches? Just a yes or no answer. Because I remember reading in your book, there were doors off of offices that had beds in them, and I was wondering why, since these people had epic homes with nice beds.
There were what is known as option girls, who would be pretty girls with no particular talent other than private talents, who would be on the payroll, and the hierarchy, the major producers would often have one of these girls assigned to them, as it were.
Really?
Yeah.
Assigned to them?
Well, no, it wouldn't be official, but the girls kind of understood that this was part of the deal, and the producers understood that this was part of the deal, and it was just the way business was done. This was not only MGM, this was industry-wide. Sure. And basically, the hierarchy at the studio would have mistresses on the company payroll, mm-hmm. Is the way it worked out. Now, I talked to secretaries who worked at the MGM, the Thalberg building at MGM. Mayer didn't do that. He was very correct, but...
He didn't know how to.
No, he
I
was
don't think
not...
He would know how to be a womanizer.
I suspect he was a virgin on his wedding night. Because I think he would have been worried about getting a terrible disease if he'd gone to a hooker in Haverhill or St. John. You know, he just wasn't that. Because for one thing, he was homely, and he knew he was homely. And generally, a homely man who knows his homely is going to be either Harvey Weinstein, who's going to use everything he has got for leverage, or he's going to be too shy to put himself forward. You know, Mayer was very shy and awkward with women, and he didn't. He might have dabbled once or twice in
right. Unsuccessfully
25 years. Think. Yeah. But
so what's very disappointing in reading about a man such as LB, that not that I had a preconceived, but when his wife had a hysterectomy, his mm-hmm. whole attitude towards her changed. It was almost like he wrote her off. Can you briefly tell us about that?
She had a hysterectomy. This is in the late 1930s. And Margaret had a hysterectomy, and it sent her into a spiraling depression.
Sure.
Now, today, of course, there's all sorts of things that can be done when this happens, the chemical imbalance and all that. There was nothing in 1930. She was just depressed, and she stopped functioning, crying, sitting in a dark room. She was no longer a wife to him, as he told his daughters. And Mayer had a strong sex drive. And he didn't know what to do. He didn't know how to get through to her because he placed great trust in doctors. One of his dearest friends was a female doctor. He didn't want Irene to become a doctor, but his personal physician was a woman. Go figure. Jessie Marmerston, a wonderful woman. And he just didn't know what to do. And it was at that point that he started edging away from her. Because he felt she'd abandoned him, and he didn't understand why. He thought it was he realized that there was some sort of cause and effect with the hysterectomy, but he couldn't figure out why she was rejecting him in a way she'd never had before.
She couldn't. And he, of course, didn't discuss it.
She was clinically depressed. She couldn't articulate anything. And it was terribly difficult for Irene, because Irene adored her father and adored her mother, and she could see what was happening.
Yeah. Just an FYI, in 1937, LB made about $1.3 million. He paid the government in income taxes $1.1 million. So you can understand why he and others hated Roosevelt at the time. Correct?
Of course, he still ends up with $150,000. $150,000 in 1937 is a couple million today.
Sure.
So it's not like he was standing on the corner selling apples.
Right. So Thalberg slips into a coma and he dies around September 13th at the young age of 37. So basically, what happens at MGM? It's never really gets its sort of, even though good films were coming out of the Wizard of Oz, Waterloo Bridge, Ninochka, The Philadelphia Story, Strike Up the Band, and The Women, among many others. Mm-hmm. Great films were still happening, but what followed?
Well, Thalberg, as I said, had a rheumatic heart, and he caught a cold over Labor Day in 1936, and a week later he was dead. The cold became pneumonia, went to his lungs, his heart shut down, and he died at the age of 37 years old. Well, everybody was stunned, and in the business there was a general theory that MGM would collapse without Thalberg. Mm-hmm. And what actually happened was MGM hit its golden age. Mm-hmm. After Thalberg, mm-hmm. Because what Mayer did was take control, total control, in a way he couldn't when Thalberg was alive, because the two of them had kind of separate fiefdoms, and you were a Thalberg guy or you were a Mayer guy.
Yeah,
you know?
It happened. It separated.
It separated, and it was a way to maintain some rough balance in the studio. But Thalberg died, and so Mayer took control, and he set up the musical unit, headed by Arthur Freed, mm-hmm. which made all the, from Wizard of Oz, made all the great MGM musicals, Singing in the Rain, Gigi, all the great MGM musicals. And out comes The Wizard of Oz and Random Harvest and The Women and Philadelphia Story. Yeah. And all through the war, basically the studio was hitting nothing but home runs. Mm-hmm. So it was, in a sense, it was a validation of what Mayer had been doing or wanted to do that he hadn't quite been able to do by maintaining total control over the output right. of the studio.
So because of all that great groundwork, it's drifting now on automatic pilot for
pretty
a
much,
while.
Yeah.
Let's talk. We need to cover these. We spoke about Garbo, but we need to cover Joan Crawford. You said that she was the star that no one saw coming.
Right.
Was she a team player at the place?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she loved MGM. She loved Mayer.
The gang.
She loved Mayer. She wanted to please. What you find over and over again with actors of this generation and succeeding generations is absent or dead fathers and strong mothers. And Mayer realized early on that because he's running an adult daycare center, basically. Well, no, you've got 40 actors under contract, you've got an equal number of writers under contract, dear God, 40 writers, you've got 20 directors, you've got 25 producers. Now, given what we know about actors, writers, directors, producers, how'd you like to run that operation? Esther Williams told me this wonderful story. She walked in, this is in 1947. She walks into Mayer's office to complain about something. And he's like this. And he looks up and he says, no, not today. Not today. He said, I just spent an hour talking to Katharine Hepburn about wearing a red dress to a political rally.
Oh.
This is the sort of thing he had to deal with all the time.
He put his actor out to end the... And the conversation before it even started.
Right, right. But no, with someone like Joan Crawford, who was like him, poor, really poor, no father, rough upbringing, lower middle class on her best day, basically lower class, what he would do is play daddy because that's what she needed. That's what she wanted. She desperately was in search of a gentle, nurturing father figure. So for Joan Crawford, he would be the gentle, nurturing father figure, and she would melt, and she would do anything to please him, mm-hmm. right? Katharine Hepburn comes in. Now, Katharine Hepburn had money of her own. Her family had money. She was independently well off. She didn't need MGM. So when Katharine Hepburn would come in, he wouldn't try to play a part. He would talk to her as an equal, intellectual equal, a social equal. And as a result, she adored him. She said he was the most honest man she ever met in Hollywood, hands down, because he just talked to her as if she was a man, because he respected her, and he would have let her produce movies, he would have let her direct movies, because she was like his daughter Irene, a woman that you could not buffalo. So he respected her because he didn't even try to buffalo her, because he was smarter than that. But he would gauge what that person needed from him and then try to provide it, as long as it also got him what he wanted.
And he'd smack her on her wrist when she was married to John Gilbert and screwing around with Clark Gable and, sure, I suppose, others.
Joan?
Good for,
yeah,
her.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
I mean, if she, that's, he didn't, what she wanted to,
no,
do.
No, he understood.
The image, right?
He was socially conservative and he was politically conservative, but he also understood that all these corporate assets left the studio and went home at night. So what they did on their own time was their own business, unless it impinged upon the work at the studio. So he didn't attempt to interfere unless it got dangerous. And then he would come in with both feet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Speaking about misbehaving, because we have to get going on Lana Turner, just, I mean, to summarize.
We don't have enough time.
No, the thing is, he said she was a whore, but a reliable one.
Yeah.
What? And she wasn't the world's greatest actress, but you could not look at that presence on the screen.
No.
So sum up her life there.
There were two actors who gave him fits. Mickey Rooney and Lana Turner. More or less for the same reason.
Bad girl.
Yeah, exactly. Rooney, and I mean, I knew Rooney. I interviewed him several times, and he was in like 85, and he was shot out of a cannon. I mean, he was manic. I could only imagine what he was like at 25. And I mean, he would set himself the goal of nailing as many of the girls around the lot as he could. And he would go at it, and he was successful because he was Mickey Rooney. He was a huge star, which always helps. Lana, I wouldn't call her promiscuous. I would just call her extraordinarily friendly. But she was, again, no father.
Okay.
And she was desperately searching for some kind of reassurance. So that was the way she filled her need, you know?
He gave her a great career. She gave him plenty.
She didn't mind him. She wasn't close to him. Crawford adored Mayer. Kate Hepburn adored Mayer. Mm-hmm. Turner was not. I don't know that she had the overall objectivity,
right,
that a Hepburn did or a Crawford did, mm-hmm, about what Mayer was doing for her. Mm-hmm. You know.
I find it interesting that he actually advised the shy Robert Young to go move out of your parents' house and have more sex,
mm-hmm,
so you'll be a little bit more appealing. He was, mm-hmm, a bit of a yenta too.
Oh God, yes. Yeah. But see, he would never say that to his daughters.
No, that's what I mean.
He would have had a heart attack if someone had said that to his daughters. But, you know, Robert Young on screen, if you look at Robert Young on screen, he's okay, but he doesn't have much effect.
No, he doesn't have what you would call a dynamic sex
appeal. No, he doesn't burn through the screen the way Gable did, for instance, you know. He didn't have to tell Gable to get more sex. That was that was understood.
Right. Gable was great. He was a person's a colleague's colleague, and, mm-hmm, but when 5 o'clock
gone
rolled around, he was saying no. We
in can't. The middle of a shot, he would leave at five o'clock.
He was loved by everybody.
But yeah,
I'll tell you what disappointed me when I read and that LB said his excuse for leaving his wife was that I'm leaving Margaret because she's too good for me.
Mm-hmm.
Is anybody that dumb in this room or in this world?
No.
Anyway, his divorce settlement, believed to be the highest in history of American courts at the time, $3.250, give or take, correct?
$3.2 million. But you know who negotiated the divorce?
Who?
Irene, their daughter.
Oh, okay.
She told her father what he was going to give her mother for the settlement, and he wrote the check. Because he wasn't going to argue with her.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Because he knew better than to argue with her.
Then he married Lorena D. Danker?
Lorena Danker, who is a widow.
Former Busby Berkeley girl. He was 63. She was 41. He adopts her daughter. Mm-hmm. And then Doris Sherry comes into the picture briefly. Tell us about this man who sort of replaced Thalberg in a way.
That was the idea. In 1947, MGM loses money for the first time in its history. Now, think about this. They never lost money in the Depression. Now, in the Depression, Paramount goes into receivership, Warner Brothers is teetering, and RKO goes into receivership. So you had three of the five major studios confronting bankruptcy. MGM makes money every year. That's how strong their bond with the public was. But in 1947, for the first time in their history, they lost like $900,000. Now, in and of itself, this is a minor thing. But what was clear was is that Mayer's formula was starting to falter because all the millions of people that came back from World War II didn't necessarily want to see the same kind of movies that they had seen before World War II. The audience's interest had changed. The film started getting rougher, more violent, more sexual, and Mayer was adamantly opposed to more violence and more sex in movies. Again, he wanted to idealize movies. So MGM, the corporate boys in New York, brought in Doris Sherry, a younger man by about 20-some years, who had done good work at RKO, to basically be Thalberg and to inject a more au courant stream into what the pictures MGM was making. And Mayer took it as an affront.
He gave an ultimatum.
Ultimately. They worked together for 3 years, and then Mayer made probably the biggest mistake of his life. He went to Nick Schenck, who was the head of Lowe's Incorporated, the parent company of MGM in New York, and said, it's him or it's me. Mm-hmm. And Nick Schenck chose Doris Sherry.
Yeah.
And that was it. Mayer tendered his resignation.
Was it?
1951.
So he made a not so wonderful deal for himself regarding selling residual interest.
Mayer had, by contract, 10% of the profits of every one of 800 films MGM had made under Mayer. And he sold off his 10% for $2.75 million.
Mamma mia.
Now, television's already landed at this in 1951. Television's here. That film library is going to be extraordinarily valuable. And he's selling it for, he could easily have tripled that money. Mm. But what I think was happening was he wanted, it was part of the divorce. He wanted to get out and just get out. He was so angry and so bitter because his name's on the masthead. It's Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer.
Yeah, yeah.
And they had chosen this schlub over him.
Right.
Schlub. He was just livid, like King Lear livid.
And it's almost like the lifeline was pulled out of him the minute he was no longer there. He was out of sorts. He was in his late 60s, which is, by today's standards and in this zip code, that's a twink.
Right.
Right?
Right.
But
right.
In those days, he was getting on. And his doctor said, well, the best case scenario, it's you're anemic. Mm-hmm. Worst case, leukemia. Mm-hmm. Let's just call it old age.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out to be leukemia eventually, but he was lost, and
he was Napoleon on Elba. He had no empire. His empire, his fiefdom was gone. Now he had plenty of money. He bought some properties. He bought Paint Your Wagon, the lovely musical, and he could have produced movies, but he couldn't quite pull the trigger. And I asked Dan Selznick. I said, so there's 6 years between the time he leaves MGM and his death. I said, now he had the money. There were all sorts of people in Hollywood that would have cut him a check if he didn't want to finance it himself. Why couldn't he do it? And Dan said, he didn't think in terms of making one movie. He thought in terms of making 40.
Yeah.
He thought in terms of three musicals and three love stories and a remake of Grand Hotel. And he thought about the whole. He was like a caterer with a menu. It wasn't just one dish. It was all these different dishes. He said he thought in large terms. Mm-hmm. And one film, he just couldn't bring himself to focus on one film. And of course, he was livid. He was angry. He was short-tempered. Yeah. It was a miserable, miserable ending for him.
Heavy stuff. He died October 29th, 1957. He was 72 or 73.
Yeah.
his daughter Irene and Kate Hepburn, who adored him and spoke highly of him throughout her entire life, planned the funeral, 2,000 people inside, 3,000 people outside. Mm-hmm. So he made an impact.
Oh yeah, everybody came. Not just to make sure he was dead. That's what they said about Harry Cohn when Harry Cohn died, who ran Columbia Pictures. Right. And Danny Kaye said, just goes to show you, give the public what it wants, they show up. But I mean, everybody understood that Mayer was an embodiment of a time and a place and a way of making movies that was vanishing, just as he had, at the same time, simultaneously vanishing.
His estate was worth $7.5 million-ish. Mm-hmm. Oh, what it would have been, maybe 8-9 times that amount had the income taxes not been
sure,
so high.
Sure, sure. Or if he'd taken more money for his 10% of the films. Yeah.
And the divvying up of his estate and the various disappointments. He left Edie, that daughter, nothing.
He disinherited his daughter, Edie.
And his wife, Lorena, only got $750,000.
Right, right. He disinherited Edie because in 1952, her husband and she, along with Dorie Sherry, hosted a fundraiser for Adlai Stevenson, who was running for president. And Mayer didn't care about Adlai Stevenson. What enraged him was the fact that she was doing a social event with Dorie Sherry, who he blamed for maneuvering him out of MGM. He yelled, he screamed. Edie said she had to back up her husband because it was her husband who'd set the thing up with Dorie Sherry. Mayer felt she'd betrayed him. And so he not only did he cut her out of the will, he cut her children out of the will.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
His grandchildren out of the will.
That's creepy.
Yeah. Well,
they didn't do anything.
It was Old Testament. See, he there was Old Testament LB and there was New Testament LB. And when thwarted and when angered, he flipped into Old Testament LB.
What I found really disappointing, among other things, well, the Mayer Foundation attorney, Myron Fox, was thick as thieves with LB's wife, Lorena. And they burned 99% of his papers. So much more information about his life, we'll never know.
Well, the detail. Danny Selznick told me that in the notes that LB would send to him for his birthday or for Christmas, he said he didn't have any education. There weren't any capital letters on the notes, and the words would be misspelled. And Lorena thought she was protecting him by making sure that stuff wouldn't survive, that people would be able to denigrate him from being ignorant.
Well, they could have fixed it. So you say in your book wonderful, wonderful things, and I all recommend that you all buy this book and his others. Men like LB are seldom reflective because they're born with the desire to outrun their past. Not so unusual for people from that time, immigrants in particular, who weren't treated so well in Russia and then here, the continued discrimination. Mm-hmm. You also said Louis B. Mayer was not afraid of dying. He was afraid of making a bad picture. How many pictures was he responsible for?
About 800.
And this year, MGM puts out?
Two or three.
A year?
A year.
Okay. And FYI, everyone, from 27 to 48, MGM got 22 Academy Awards. The 20 years that followed after LB, they got 7. So, Scott, what would you say would be the one biggest misconception about LB? We've gotten into some serious detail about him.
That he was some sort of early version of Harvey Weinstein. That he was crude and coarse and vulgar and ruled by a fear. Mm-hmm. Which he was never coarse unless it was for effect. And he wasn't crude at all. I was able to get some tape recordings of his speeches because I wanted to hear what he sounded like, you know? And he spoke beautifully. And I was stunned because I figured he would sound like, I don't know, Jack Warner, who sounded like a gangster, who talked like a gangster, because essentially he was a gangster. But LB had no accent at all. He spoke, he had a lovely speaking voice, and he was very good with a script, and he spoke elegantly. And it really brought home to me the extent to which he was a self-made figure, considering where he started. Look at where he started. One step ahead of the pogroms.
Underwater.
In Russia. And look at where he ended up.
Yeah.
And look at what the changes he affected, not only in himself, but in American culture, while doing it.
Sure. One best friend at the end of his life, who would that be?
Clarence Brown, director.
The director.
The director, who left MGM just about the time Mayer did because he didn't want to work for Dorry Sherry, and he never made another movie.
Biggest enemy.
In Mayer's mind, Dorry Sherry.
Mm-hmm.
Time, really. Time was his enemy. But time is everybody's enemy.
So a final question. What would you say to LB, or what would you ask him if you had the opportunity today? What's missing in your curiosity after all of this research, if anything?
Why did you go to Nick Schenck and tell him it's him or it's me? Why did you provoke a confrontation that probably could have been finessed?
Yeah.
Why did you exile yourself to Elba?
Mm-hmm. What's a favorite book that you've done of the 15 plus you're working on? Can you tell us about the book you're working on now?
I'm calling it Brilliant Disguise, The Life of Cary Grant.
Oh, another funny looking man. I want to thank Scott on behalf of everyone at the Kravis Center and thank all of you for being here. Great job. You're awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.